me a separate course or a separate 1 month for that in discussing that. Just if I'm talking about India only, ignoring the other geographical areas, right? But this module will be a very small module, but a very specific module, okay? Or probably, I guess, this module can be even completed in this, you know, one day, in this one class, or max one and a half, right? And then we'll move on to the next module, right? So without any further ado delay, I'll just start sharing my screen. Let me know once the screen is visible. In fact, I had already shared the notes for this particular class in a form of a web page that, you know, I had created. Still, I'm sharing it once again on Skype chat. Yes. I had created this in Notion app, basically. So just a minute. Oops. Yeah, sorry. So a general understanding of cyber laws. Okay. So this module will give you an overview on cyber laws in general, right? As cyber investigation is referred as a techno-legal field, so it is important for us at least to have a basic idea about cyber laws. See, it's not something that as an investigator or in terms of something learning about cyber crime, we should have knowledge of each and every law or something like that. Not even important, not at all necessary. Even if you're working for a law enforcement agency, something like that, still not necessary. Because it's not us, it's not the private investigators who deal with legalities, right? Basically, we only do, you can say, investigations and are responsible for that only. So now, but why yet we are actually discussing this is due to the fact that it is important for us at least to be aware of these kind of things, right? Because it's a techno-legal field or of a, again, right? So before we jump into the laws and something, a bit of discussion about modern cyber laws, okay? That how this cyber laws and everything, you know, came up into action. What was the increase in the crime ratio suddenly, and why these things actually came up, right? These are the general discussion things that we are going to do. So how this all actually started, basically. So anyone, you know, let's make this class a bit interactive before that. Anyone who can actually state an idea that what was the difference between traditional crime scenario and the modern cyber crime scenario? What do you feel? What was the ultimate goal of traditional threat actors? And what's the goal of modern threat actors for today's time? Right? What do you feel? Or any drastic, you know, curve growth of some graph that you have seen in the past couple of years in the cyber world? Come on. Let's not, you know, make my voice only boring for 1 hour, right? You can interact too. Yeah, so someone is typing. Yeah, sir.
Sorry. I just want to tell that from traditional cybercrime is probably, it's a lot about the tracking and proving that the crime was was done in a certain way.
Okay. But what, sir, do you think, what was the traditional goal? Like, what was the goal of a traditional threat actor? So if I just talk about a few years back, okay, around 5 or 6 years back, what do you feel that, what was the goal of threat actors or the criminals, cyber criminals specifically? Because if you see at that time, the things were not even evolved so much as they are today.
Siphoning money.
Okay, money, exactly.
Like credit card frauds.
Exactly. Exactly correct, sir. You are absolutely correct. So that also was not the main intention, basically. Before that also, there was one intention which are going to discuss. But yeah, the credit card frauds and the debit card frauds was on the top. right? Now, let's dive into this talk further, okay? And let us discuss about a general understanding that a few years back, I'm talking about traditional cybercrime, okay? A few years back, when digitization was just born, okay? When digitization was just born, threat actors used to primarily focus on information damage. You can say the destruction of data. Damage of information was the ultimate goal. Various incidents involving worms, malwares, DOS attack, trojans, which were actually seen, which were resulting in the damage of sensitive data, or it's completely, or it's, you know, it's destruction, right? Or you can say a tampering to a such an extent where it cannot be used again. That was the ultimate goal of threat actors. Now, what became, you can say, exactly vandalism again. Good point. Now, adding to the modern cyber crimes, right? From the last couple of years, with rapid increase of digitization, there has been a rapid increase in cyber crimes. Since 2012, there was a drastic increase and growth in terms of global data and internet usage along the globe. Okay, along the globe. This led to evolution of cybercrime as later threat actors decided to focus on information theft and not information damage. So there is a lot of difference between, and I'm saying information theft and information damage. So the data which was actually focused on, which was meant to be destructed, now the same data is considered to be a wealth for hackers. Or you can, not even hackers, cyber criminals. Let's not use any layman term over here, okay? For cyber criminals. So now, the what is the ultimate focus of threat actors is not information damage, but the ultimate focus is rather information theft. So this is how the evolution take place, and you know, this is what the main reason that actually threat the cyber crimes was, the graph was, you know, the curve, the nature of the crime was actually evolved in such a way. This led to create a sense of fear. As a result of this, various companies, okay, as a result of this, various companies started to, you can see what they started to adopt and you can say learn about, or started to understand the value about information security systems, or information security, basically. Systems, just ignore the term systems, right? Because it depends, various mechanism or technical terms that are involving. But due to this fact, companies, government sectors, NGOs, small scales, startups, non-profits, they started to understand and learn about information security, right? Now, for example, threat actors started to steal sensitive information from the users, such as debit, credit card numbers, passwords, CVVs, then resulting some amount of, you can say, all this adding up to a credit or debit card fraud at, you know, Srijit sir already gave a point on this, right? To make this scenario understand in a better way, the following rough estimates are given. So, talking in 2012, digital economy started to gain some boost. Okay. Cyber criminals were now focusing on information theft rather than information damage. From then, the time shortages, and they have also, you know, launched some of the fund initiatives to reveal crisis where it sees an opportunity for joint in action, right? So, I mean, it's not something that we can actually talk about a lot about G7 and its, you know, complete factors in the digital economy on that they are working on. You can find that easily on the web, and I'm going to share references for that, right? Not at all, no worries in that. But what I am discussing in general over here is the fact that these are some of the, you can say, organizations or the global, you know, groups formed which are actually focusing on this area. So G7 is mainly for economical issues, and economy also includes digital economy as a part. So they have been working on digital economy also, and how digital economy can be stabilized better. Now I expect you know the answer of it in a much better way, right? Now you should also be aware of this you can say body, FATF, which is Financial Action Task Force, FATF. It's one of the most famous and, you can say, well-known reputed body. The Financial Action Task Force is a global money laundering and terrorist financing watchdog. This intergovernmental body sets international standards. So this is responsible for setting some international standards that aim to prevent illegal activities and the harm they cause to the society. As a policy-making body, FATF works to generate necessary political will to bring about national legislative and regulatory reforms in these areas. With more than 200 countries and jurisdictions committed in implementing to them, FATF has developed the FATF recommendations or FATF standards, which ensure a co-oriented global response to prevent organized crime, corruption, and terrorism. Crime also includes digital crime, digital financial crimes. They help authorities to go after the money of criminals dealing in illegal drugs, human trafficking, and other sort of crimes. And trust me, this is something important in terms of investigator, because the illegal drugs, human trafficking, it's not only a physical crime that has been taking, and the funds are not only channelized in a physical format. In fact, today the funds are very less channelized in a physical format. Anyone knows how these kind of things are done on a digital basis? How the funds are channelized over here? Anyone? Anyone? If I'm talking about these kind of things, illegal drugs, human trafficking, involving in the laundering of money through a digital channel, what it could be? Exactly. And to be honest, I'm sorry, I was expecting this answer from you only, right? It's absolutely a good one. So dark web, dark net, right? Bitcoins are the channel used for this money laundering in a digital world for involving in these kind of crimes. Go on to the dark net, you will find all the illegal drugs. Go on to the dark net, you'll be able to do human trafficking and hire hitmen and all those other things. So FATF also works to stop funding for weapons of mass destruction. The FATF reviews money laundering and terrorist financial techniques and continuously strengthens its standards to address new risks, such as regulation of virtual assets. See, as I told you, regulation of virtual assets, which have spreaded as cryptocurrencies gain popularity. The FATF monitor countries to ensure that they implement FATF standards fully and effectively, and holds the countries, okay, to count that do not comply, with those standards. So a bit of history about FATF. FATF was established in July in the year of 1989. And who established FATF? G7. By a group of seven in the summit. There was G7 summit in Paris, right? Initially to examine and develop measures to combat money laundering. And the outcome was FATF. In October 2001, probably the year when I was born, FATF expanded its mandate to incorporate efforts to combat terrorist financing in addition to money laundering. And in April 2012, it added efforts to counter the financing of, proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, such as nuclear weapons and all. Since its inception, FATF has operated under a fixed lifespan, recruiting a specific decisions by its ministers to continue. Three decades after its creation, in April 2019, recently, FATF ministers adopted a new open-ended mandate for FATF. The objectives of FATF are to set standards, right? And which you already know that what are the standards and what are the aims for which the FATF is there, right? This link I have shared over here. Let's open this link, which gives a list of FATF members. So who are FATF members and observers? 39 are the members of FATF. Wherein India is also there, one of them FATF member. Okay. You can look out for your countries and who are the observers? Indonesia, associate members. These are the associate members. So India lies within the, yes, UK is in, obviously. Right, UK is in. And associate members, you can say these are be divided into groups according to the members, right? So for example, India lies in Asia Pacific. So Asia Pacific groups on money laundering, APG, right? So the channel is that the channel they'll work on will be APG. And this is how the main reporting will be directly you know, provided to the FATF body, FATF community. These are the observer organizations. The site has also been provided over here. Can go and see their publications also. The recent publications. See virtual assets. There is a publication on virtual assets. Publication of FATF standards has been there over here. Right? And which were, these standards were amended in 2020. And then there was something consolidated process and procedures for mutual evaluations and follow-up. These standards were amended in 2021. Just a month ago, January. Right? But these are the some things which cannot be discussed, you know, the whole day throughout the class, right? So this is something which you can go as a self-study process. If you want additional info about it, right? Oops. Yeah. Then, as I said, I won't be able to, you know, discuss each and every law according, you can say, to the geographical unit and all. But this above document, you know, this document which already is provided over here, what it compares about the cyber crimes and the, I mean, not about cyber crimes specifically, but about the legislations and the laws are compared between UK and India. So, you know, this is something interesting. Can anyone say me what is the similarity or, you know, can say between UK and India legislations? There are a lot of similarities. Lot means a lot of similarities. It's like you can say somewhat almost the same. But, you know, still the points in out that are there to compare are in this PDF. And we are going to discuss this PDF, okay, in a brief to get an idea about the legislations. Okay. Now, so in this way, the report has been divided. Methodologies, then there is comparison of cybersecurity policies in India and UK. And there is something more, you know, which we'll see, right? So now it's a question for all of you. See, this particular, you know, module for cyber laws, it's for a generalized purpose because our actual focus is not cyber laws. Our actual focus is cyber crime as an investigator, right? So now you all give me a choice according to your interest. Shall we go through this PDF as an official, you know, courseware for our class? Or is it something that you wanted as a side read material? But if you want it as a side read material, I'll make it compulsory as an assignment. And there will be a test on it. Now, this decision is up to you all.
I'm okay with it.
Cyber, this is not exactly, sir, cyber laws. See, cyber laws in the sense they are, you know, certain, you know, actually acts, right? Which are actually there in the constitute. Which if I start to discuss about each and every country, it will take a lot of time, right? So this particular, you know, module for cyber laws, it focuses on generalized idea about the laws and all its working. And we have taken UK and India as an example for this documentation is the fact that they are quite similar. And it is, you know, it helps us to understand the scenario much better about the cyber legislations. Okay. So Sam sir are like, this stuff can be done, you know, without including in the off classes, in the in classes basis. I want a surety from you all as well, right? I just feel that Sam sir are only enjoying the class since it start. Others, about others? Yeah, let's vote. So again, I'm repeating the question. This particular module on cyber laws, it's mainly for a broader aspect and understanding about it, not in terms of becoming a, you know, digital advocate, right? So up to you now, because our prime area of interest is cyber crime and PI and not cyber laws. There are two options which I'm giving you all. We can go through this entire PDF as a part of our actual courseware during our class hours, or you can use this PDF for self-reading purposes as an assignment on which a test will be conducted. Okay. Self-reading. Everyone up for it? Okay. Cool. So, let's discuss about this. Okay. So, I mean, this, I'll just give you a quick idea about this report. I mean, I won't go through it because you all have opted for the option for self-reading. I myself have went through this entire document. It's very amazing to read. Okay. It's, yes. I know it's about laws. I am a lazy person in terms of understanding laws. Trust me, I have been into this field of cybersecurity since 4 years. But till now, I rarely find someone who enjoy reading about laws and legislations, right? At least from my own circle. But this is a document which actually I went through entire 24 pages, and it's quite a good, it's a very great read basically. You can get a clear picture or a, you know, vivid view about the legislation, cyber legislation specifically, right? So what exactly this document contains? It contains the first method, you know, comparison is in terms of methodology for dealing with cybersecurity. Okay, a few metrics have been, you know, taken off. So what are the scopes and what are the methodologies or what are the strategies that these countries have been adopting in terms of dealing with cyber security or cyber crimes in general? Okay, so there you can, you know, go through this as a methodology perspective. So there are five you can say metrics that have been, you know, outlined in this. And there is a comparison of cybersecurity policy in India and between the UK. So how it all started basically, and you can say what was the history when it, a few years ago since it was, you know, amended. Oh. And what are the legal aspects in looking at it? why was that comment actually added out? So in terms of UK, what was the social and political background and the legislative history? Then the legal anecdotes, the key findings on the history, and then again in terms of scope of cyber security in terms of India. Why these two are actually coming? Because these two are quite similar, almost similar. Then assessment of criticality, I mean all these other categories of threats on which the how the NCIIPC, right? If in India, who are in India who knows about NCIIPC, you should know about NCIIPC, right? So how the NCIIPC, you know, defines the guidelines and all. Sir, I know this will be a long read, but trust me, as per my experience, I have went through it. It won't, you know, make you feel bored at all. It's a good read. If you just start with a few pages, you'll automatically get a vibe, you know, to complete this entire 24. And probably it's a less read, I feel. Just 24 pages. What do you mean by 24 pages? Nothing. Right. Then what is, apart from that, what is included in this document? 20. Okay. So how these organizations are actually working? What are the governing bodies, such as for UK, what it is? For India, it is NCIIPC. Right? Anyone who knows the full form is NCIIPC? Note down in the chat. What are the cybersecurity structures according to India for public, private, you can say, so wherein you will get a complete information about various bodies that have been involved, such as DSCI. I'm very close, you know, noticing the work of DSCI because I myself did a certificate for that. The exam was of DSCI only. And NASSCOM, which is, so DSCI is an initiative of NASSCOM. It's about it. Then FICCI, AUSPI, CAOI, COAI. These are the bodies that have been, you know, working in cybersecurity, right? It's complete idea about this is given over here, right? Then there is ISAC. I've also been very closely working with ISAC, Information Sharing and Analysis Center. Its full form is ISAC, right? So you can just, you know, go through this. Then the same thing is applies for, you know, UK. So what are the government, you can say, initiatives or the industries on how they are, you know, working on the amendments and all. right? So there is, you know, CBEST in UK government itself involving, right? There is schemes that are then being present. Then what are the institutional frameworks such like India? So there is NCSC. I mean, Sam, sir, you could know about this if you have some idea. CERT. So that's the reason I'm, you know, emphasizing quite a lot in reading this entire PDF, and you all have made a decision for self-read, and there will be a self-assessment also just to make sure that I can understand that how much you have read it, how much you have, you know, absorbed the content from it. Probably, right? So you can go through this entire PDF. My aim was to go through this class, but it's okay. It's not that important in terms of the context of the class, but it is very important in terms of context or a GK that you should own as a PI. Okay. So this document where you will find, you'll directly find it in this, you know, Notion page. Here it is, you know, provided this PDF. Okay. Now, this is something, I mean, these are some links that have been provided for additional references, right? So now this is something again I'm discussing in terms of globally, not specifically somewhere, but globally and, you know, other aspects that is, you know, in place. So a final general assembly vote to adopt the resolutions. I mean, just go through this if you want. Convention on Global Cybercrime, which includes information about Budapest Convention. So the Council of Europe, CUE, Europe Council, COE, Cybercrime Convention is also known as the Budapest Convention. It was open for signature in 2001 and came into force in 2004. Right, so the convention is the solely legally binding international military treaty on cybercrime. So you can say it's an international treaty in terms of dealing with, you can say, cyber crimes. It coordinates cybercrime investigations between nation states and criminalizes certain cybercrime conduct. It serves as a guideline for any country developing comprehensive national legislation against cybercrime, and as a framework for international cooperation between state parties to this treaty. So this Budapest Convention is supplemented by a protocol on xenophobia, I just ignore if I'm spelling it wrong, and racism, committed through computer systems. It's just, you know, specific protocols have been added into this convention. Significance: almost all stakeholders agree that a current form of cross-border data sharing for law enforcement through Mutual Legal Assistance Treaty, MLAT, is insufficient for digital age. However, there is an ongoing debate whether to revamp MLDT or to form an entirely a new system for cyber crimes, you know, in the form of this convention. This convention has eagerly called for Indian participants since its formation 2001. But unfortunately, India has decided not to be a part of it, at least till now. Okay. A Russia-led resolution. Now, this is something in terms of, you know, countries. Okay. And this is something which I'm discussing to give you an overlaid global idea about all the things that are happening in the global cyber law or cyber legislative, you know, area. Right. This is why I'm, you know, discussing these things. That is why these are included in the courseware. And I guess this is something useful, right? So you can additionally go and research about MLAT also. And you can also go and just see what are the, you can say, the conditions, the standards that are present in MLAT, which, you know, this kind of, you know, stakeholders are feeling that it which is insufficient as of now. And the Russia-led resolution. The Russia proposal entitled Countering the Use of Information and Communication Technologies for Criminal Purposes was recently put forward in UNGA. This recent UN proposal follows previous Russian initiatives, including the draft United Nations Convention on Cooperation in Combating Cybercrime, started in 2017, to develop a UN Convention on Cybercrime. This is something which Russia have done. This is something which European Union have came up with. Okay. A Russia proposal calls for creation of a committee that will convene in August 2020 in New York in order to establish a newly treaty through which nation states can coordinate and share data to prevent cybercrime. So this draft convention goes far beyond what Budapest Convention allows for regarding the cross-border access to data, including limiting the ability of, you know, signatory to refuse to provide access to the requested data. This is the reason why several human rights groups criticize the UN proposal as a way to extend the Chinese and Russia form of internet governance, so-called as closed internet or state-controlled internet. If this resolution will be passed by UNGA, it will become second international convention on cybercrime. Russia and China question the Budapest Convention on the grounds of national sovereignty issues, thereby proposing their own treaty at the UN. What is that? Where India stands within all this, right? So India maintained its status as a non-member for the Europe-led Budapest Convention, although India has voted a green signal for Russia's led UN resolution to set up a separate convention and do not go up with the European Union's Budapest Convention. According to Intelligence Bureau, IB, in India, data sharing with foreign law enforcement agencies infringes on national sovereignty of India. India has also previously argued that it will not sign on to Budapest Treaty since it was drafted without its participation. And how India has been working on this? So there are some data protection laws in India. And let me just, you know, first clear about it. Then I'll, you know, come to it a bit more, giving an insight that. So data protection laws in India are currently facing many problems and resentments due to the absence of proper legislative framework. And there are something, you know, legal framework that, you know, at least Sam sir, you should know about in terms of Indian context, or Indians also should know. IT Act 2000. So this is the Information Technology Act. IT Act content provisions. Which are these provisions? 43A and 72A regarding cyber related and IT related laws in India. So section 43A has a specific clause for compensation for failure to protect the data, sensitive data. Your data, it means personal data, personal identifiable data, SPI, that is sensitive personal data, HPI, health related personal data, and 72A. It deals with any information knowing or internationally without the consent of the person that has been concerned and made punishable with imprisonment for a term extending for 3 years. This is something for, again, data protection also. 43A deals with body corporates. And I assume that you know what I'm referring to as body corporates. So 43A deals with body corporates. Okay. However, these provisions in India neither protect any breach of information on one hand, nor they enforce a right-based framework on privacy. Right. So in 2017, Justice K.S. Puttaswamy versus Union of India, that was, you know, going on. They actually came up with a fundamental right to privacy that forms an intrinsic part of life and liberty under Article 21 of India. And therefore, there is a protection. You can say there is another term that has been, you know, piling up as a bill. It's yet to be, you know, converted into an act. It's yet in the form of a bill, which is known as Data Protection Bill. DBP. That is Data Protection Bill. Yeah, it's 2018. It came up in 2018, but the DBP bill, the data protection bill, it was again amended in 2019. Okay. And it's still being discussed in, you know, under the ministry. Probably there is a good hope, at least this year. No one is quite assured, but probably there is a hope it will be, you know, released somewhere in this year, in the end of this year, data protection bill. Okay. Which is also known as PDB, Privacy Data Protection Bill, PDB. If you just personal data protection bill. If you refer this term, who is working in terms of privacy and data protection, it is also known as PDB Bill of India. PDB. PDB 2019. Probably this will be enacted as an act rather than as a, which will, you know, it won't stay a bill anymore. It will be approved and enacted as an act into the constitution. Probably we are hoping by the end of this year. In case, if you all want references for PDB bill, I do have it. Okay, because I have been, you know, taken a certification on this only, data protection, where I was attending the training program for DSCI. So you can just, you know, go through and compare PDB bill with GDPR and with other compliances that are in action. So I have a document. If you want me to share, why I am asking you, I'll just share only. So I have a document of IAPP, International Association of Privacy Professional, wherein they have provided quite a good outline comparing GDPR and PDB bill, which is yet to come in India. And I am giving it as, you can say, references, because it's not the actual point of context in discussing, but trust me, it is very much important to go through. And let me just check. Just give me a minute, okay? Yesterday, I guess I had downloaded it a few days ago. Let me just give a minute. That is quite optional, but if you want to get better, clear picture in terms of data protection also, then I recommend a must read. It's a must read again. Just give me a minute. I exactly need to see where I had saved it. Thanks.
What does my apps?
Just a minute. I recommend you to go through that for sure. Just GDPR. Okay, I'll just see where I have downloaded it, and I'm going to share it. Okay, I'll just share it. Okay, in a while or so, I'll just re-download it again. Make sure you use it for your reference and don't, you know, distribute it. Because it's only for members only. So being a student member, I have privilege to download it. But I'll just share it for your references. Go through that also. I'll just share it by the end of the day today. Okay. And coming to a last come point. Again, this is a kind of a reference. And there are a lot of other references you can get. I'm talking about India. Just to, you know, give you an idea that how the laws have been categorized. So mainly in India, there are two, you know, we can say things that have been taken into consideration. IPC, which is Indian Penal Code, and the IT Act, which is known as amended, right? So these are the two legislations that are, constitutes taken into consideration in India. Okay. So here you can see section, there are different sections. Section 65 deals with tampering with computer source documents. So, in short,
whosoever
actually, you know, tampers or destroys or alters the
computer source,
right? So, what are the changes, what are the imprisonment ratios and the fine, the amount that has to be liable, who the person is liable for paying. As a digital forensic practice, as a PI, I know it's not much involvement in digital forensics, but there is certain involvement of digital forensics because PI is also dealing with digital evidence. When it comes to integrity of digital evidence, we are going to discuss an important
biceps
within the section 65, that is
65B,
so in terms of digital evidence.
Back, chest.
Okay. Anyone who knows about it, it's for India basically. Okay. Chat section is open for you all.
Okay.
Let me know what you know about it. Although we are going to have a discussion on it still.
Using password
of another person. Then section 66.
At the speed of using another computer
resource or any computer resource. 66E deals with publication of private images of others. 66F
is actual
cyber terrorism. 67 deals with, I mean, it's not just one section, but there are various subsections. 67, somewhere it could be AB or something like that. I'm not good at laws. Right? So 67 deals with publishing a child pornography or predicting a children online. Where is it? Section 69, government's power to block websites.
Sorry, I just was interested. Basically, where you see in these sections? I mean,
It's completely open, sir. You can go through the entire IT Act and all sections you can see. Not in this website. I'll show you another link for doing that.
Okay, great. Sorry, yeah.
This is something just to give you a generalized idea. Right, but...
Yeah.
If you want, I'll share you that also, that you can go through each and every act. You can actually see each and every... each type of crime. Email hacking, ransomware, malware, cyber terrorism. Yeah. Each and every crime has been covered. What are the consequences?
Yeah, would be interesting just to skim it through.
Definitely. Sure, sir.
Thank you.
Yes. And section 43A, which already we have been discussed, deals with data protection at corporate level.
Oh!
So now probably you know the term, what do I meant by body corporate, right? So for corporates. And apart from this, I have been provided a general additional references, these two links, okay, which you can go through. So one is a PPT via SlideShare, International Convention on Cyber Law. Again, the things which have already been discussed about the Budapest Convention, but they are more emphasized. Okay, they are more expanded. And this is in terms of CFAA. Again, in terms of international and the ECPA and other things that have been involved. Yeah, you can go through this article as well. These are something additional references, not mandatory, just to increase your general knowledge, right? And here two things are missing, which I have promised you to share. Just I'm not finding it where I have downloaded. One is comparing India's PDB bill that is yet to arrive with Europe's GDPR. And what Sam sir just said, complete correlative list for all the sections within the IT Act. Cool. So these two I'll be adding here as well, and I'll be sharing with you separately too on Skype. Okay. So it's 11:32. Wow, fingers crossed. Exactly winded up on time, just 2 minutes ahead. Right. So this was about this module for cyber crime. Cyber laws. Cyber laws in a generalized form. Right. So you can actually just note it out that it's not in terms of actual, you know, courseware, which it's kind of compulsory to know. But see, it's a techno-legal field. Again, I'm repeating and again, I'm emphasizing on this term. It's not a technical field only. It's techno-legal. Technology and legalities. And if you're not aware of legalities, as an ethical PI, you can, you know, unintentionally land up to unethical consequences, which are against the laws, right? So it's important to know about it. So see, that's the reason I just, you know, emphasize that it's practically impossible to share about each and every things, about each and every law, about each and every section, and about each and every geographical area, you know, resembling to those. There's a reason I just talk about the overview, the global concepts, where everything, you know, where everyone is involved, you know, internationally. I have not, you know, kept this chapter as biased to some specific area. Apart from that, if you want additional resources, I'm already provided and I'm going to provide even more. Again, I'm repeating, the PDF that has been shared, go through that. There will be a test on it. Okay. And apart from that, if you want some additional resources that you are seeking for, you know, in regards to specific geographical areas, do let me know and I'll arrange it for you. Cool. Sounds good to everyone. Everyone okay and happy and satisfied for this one? Okay, noted, sir. In fact, Sam, sir, if you go through this PDF that I've, you know, which that's, you know, for you, it may be 24 page, quite long, right? You go through that PDF, you'll find it very interesting. Very interesting, because UK and India, you'll get to know a lot of about it. The entire base will be clear by going through that PDF. Okay. So, anyone, any queries till this part? It's 11:35. Probably in India, it's, you know, 11:35 p.m. We had dinner recently. Everyone awake. So let me know. Yeah, Sam, sir, you're saying something. Continue. Hello, Sam, sir, you wanted to say something?
Oh, sorry. I was actually talking. Sorry.
Okay.
I was interested. How many questions you have prepared for the assessment?
The final assessment.
Not the final assessment, about that 24 pages, that it's kind of mind-blowing for myself.
I mean, yeah, so you can expect around 20, 25, 30 questions on it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Which will be there. And it will be very simple, you know. No, it won't be twisted in any ways.
Okay.
So there will be true or false, MCQs, multiple choice questions, and bit of match the following and these kind of, you know, crumbled up, mixed up questions. And not only for this, so this will be for every module and for every test that we are going to have.
Okay, and this is going to be on that Edmodo platform, right?
Yes, it will be on the Edmodo platform.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay, and apart from this, we are also going to have a test on previous modules that are being accomplished. General crime scene. So, you know, if I just, you know, tend to ignore the general crime scene scenarios, which is not in context to the topic of cybercrime. So at least we can have a separate test on digital evidence module, where we discuss about quite a lot of things, right? Evidence collection, preservation, the frameworks, the process, then the documents, COC, system information overview and all, right? There will be a test on it, 110% sure. It's not a question made. It's a statement that I'm giving. There will be for sure. and probably I'm planning it on Friday. And on Monday, we can have a test on this one, this UK and India thing. Or we can have both combined. Up to you all. Okay. Yeah, sir, this Friday I'm planning. Because then, you know, what will happen? We have been studying a lot of concepts, right? We have been studying a lot of concepts. But then we'll actually, you know, understand that where are we landing when we actually apply our own knowledge to it. During the session, yes, during the sessions. Because to be very specific and honest, before or after the sessions, we have not seen any good responses in other courses. Right. So during the sessions, it's okay. A certain time frame will be removed out of the session, which will be dedicated for the test. I just want a thumbs up or an okay in the chat from everyone if it's okay. Cool. And then I'll wind up with today's class. Great. Assuming that everyone is cool and okay, because I see no response in the chat or nowhere. Anyways. So thanks everyone for joining this particular session. I hope you actually enjoyed. And I know it was about cyber law, so it's hard for me also to be awake in terms of cyber laws and understanding them, but it's okay. It's okay. We have to get an idea of all these things. Right? All these things that we are doing, it's the baseline for the things that for which we are being prepared. Okay. So thank you everyone. For the ones outside India, have a good day. For the ones in, have a good night. We'll meet tomorrow. Thank you.